Good morning, Radiant Church. And I want to particularly welcome those who are at our North Campus today or Woodland Park Campus, or those of you watching online. We're so glad that you've joined us. We are continuing our study of the book of Revelation today. And when we went to Revelation chapter 1, we learned what the book was really about. It's not many revelations, it's one revelation. And it's called The Revelation of Jesus Christ. And what we get more than anything else is a deeper understanding of Jesus. And of course, we know that Jesus is gracious and merciful and kind and loving. But we also find, certainly in the book of Revelation, that he can be a most severe judge. And we see that side of Jesus. And we're certainly going to see it today as we look in the book of Revelation to chapter 8. So you could turn there if you'd like, but understand that God's judgment is based on his justice. And his justice is a righteous judgment, a righteous justice. So because of that, he is extraordinarily gracious and generous as a rewarder, but he also can be a most severe judge. Psalm 89:14 says, righteousness and justice are the foundation of your throne. He's a just God. He's impartial in his judgment. And we all appreciate justice. Let's say that there was a man who was a brutal killer, that he had gone around and slaughtered people. Let's even say that he tortured them before he killed them, and he had killed hundreds of people. And he comes to court because they've apprehended him. And he stands before the judge. And the judge hears all of these brutal, horrible, awful, atrocious stories. And then it is conclusively proven, without any question, undeniably so, that he was the man that committed all of these murders. So the judge ponders and considers. He brings down his gavel and he says, not guilty. We'd be outraged. What if some of your own family members were part of those he murdered? You would be utterly outraged, and you should be, because we believe in justice. There should be justice. Somebody should pay for what happened. And we know that in the same way, we have a creator God who made all things. He made us. He created us out of love. He gave us all things to enjoy. But mankind has rebelled against God. We have gone against his benevolence and against his goodness. We've thumbed our nose at God. We've rejected God. But God in his goodness and mercy sent his son, Jesus Christ. God came in the person of Jesus. And he bore our sin. He bore our wrath. He took the wrath that you and I deserved. He died in our place so that those who put their faith in Jesus Christ and their sins are forgiven, their guilt and shame is washed away, and they are declared in the high court of heaven not guilty. But what about those who spurn that offer? What about those who reject God, who thumb their nose in his face, who reject his word, reject his people? Well, there is nothing but judgment left for those people. And as we look in the book of Revelation, we see that not only is there going to be an eternal separation from God, but that judgment is going to be seen in the book of Revelation during what is called the tribulation. There is a 7-year tribulation coming that the Bible speaks of again and again and again, and we see details of it here in the book of Revelation. Now, understand what that 7 years of tribulation is for. I think one thing that's very important to understand is it is a last call for those who don't know Jesus. It's a last call to come and repent and turn to Jesus Christ. It's God being merciful and gracious after the rapture of the church, where in Romans we hear in Romans 11 that we can see both the goodness and severity of God. The goodness of God for those who have been caught up in his presence during the tribulation, but the severity upon those on the earth. But in that severity, God yet gives them another chance, gives them an opportunity to repent, gives them an opportunity to turn to him, because that's how God is. It also is a wake-up call to the Jew. It is preparing the Jewish people, the people of Israel, for the return of their Messiah, Jesus Christ. In fact, it is called a time of Jacob's trouble. And during this time that we live in, it's called the church age, where God is mainly working through his church. During the tribulation, it's going to go back to essentially Old Testament times, where God is primarily dealing with the nation of Israel and bringing them to repentance and preparing them for the Messiah. And right now, most Jews are not accepting Christ, but in that day, we read that all of Israel is going to be saved. And finally, God is cleansing this earth, and he's preparing it for a new heaven and a new earth. Now, how God brings that judgment upon the earth is really a series of three different sevenfold judgments. And the first one we've already looked at in Revelation chapter 6, where they're called the seal judgments. Remember, there was a scroll wrapped up. It was all the plans and purposes of God for the human race. It was, you could say, the title deed of the earth. And nobody was worthy to open it until the Lamb of God, the Lion of the tribe of Judah, steps forward. And he's worthy, and he opens these seals. And there's seven different seals. And with each seal opened, there's a judgment that comes upon the earth. And compared to what's coming, they're actually quite minor. And again, it's the goodness and mercy of God giving people an opportunity to repent. And we see in Revelation chapter 7 that many are. It's going to be a great time of revival. It's going to be a great time of harvest during this period. And at the very end of these seals being opened, there's a seventh seal. We're getting ready to see it opened. And when it's opened, it then leads to the seven trumpet judgments that we're going to look at in part today. And then there's going to be the seven bowl judgments that are poured out on the earth. And you could say what we're seeing is the wrath of God upon humanity. But you have to understand that there's two aspects to the wrath of God. You could say there is the passive wrath of God. You read about that in Romans chapter 1. And it talks about those who have rejected God in this day and turned from God, that his wrath is on them. And if you read Romans 1 and then you look at your newspaper, you realize America is under the wrath of God. But it is a passive wrath of God. What we see in the book of Revelation is the active wrath of God. And so let's turn to Revelation chapter 8 and let's look at it, beginning in verse 1. Speaking of Jesus, it says, when he opened the seventh seal, so he has peeled back six straight seals, very dramatic music to go with that. And then he opens the seventh seal and it reads, there was silence in heaven for about a half an hour. Now that's interesting because we were reading what's going on in heaven and it's loud. It's very active. There's all these praises and worship to God, and then suddenly silence for about a half an hour. About a half an hour. What is this about? Well, we're going to get into it in some detail. But I think that one thing we recognize in it is that this holy hush is a calm before the storm. There's a little pause before the next series of judgments come. This hush is an expectancy awaiting for God's final judgment. There is an awe as heaven sees all the plans and the purposes of God unveiled as the seals are now all opened. And they're going to be a bit astonished at the decisive action of God upon the earth. We're going to see this. And there is more to consider about this 30 minutes of silence. And I think the primary point being made in the book of Revelation, we're going to get to in just a moment, but we need to cover more of these verses. So let's look at verse 2. John then says, and I saw the seven angels who stand before God, and to them were given seven trumpets. So there's seven angels that are waiting there to get their seven trumpets. And notice they're particular angels. Seven angels. Now to us, we have no idea who these angels are. But to John himself and to John's Jewish readers, they would know who these angels are. That's because they regularly read the book of Enoch. Now, first Enoch is not canonical. It's not in our Bible. However, what's interesting, it's quoted in our Bible. And in the book of Enoch, which they took very seriously, there are seven angels mentioned in first Enoch chapter 20. They're Uriel, Raphael. Isn't that a cool name for an angel, Raphael? Was that one of the Ninja Turtles? It was, okay. This is where he got his name. And he wasn't very angelic, if I remember. But Raguel, Michael, Seraphiel, Gabriel, and Remiel. Those were the seven angels that a Jewish person would have expected these to be. And to fully understand the book of Revelation, you don't need to understand the book of Enoch, but you do need to understand the Old Testament. Because so much is either quoted from the Old Testament, or a shadow is being cast from the Old Testament, or it's an echo back to the Old Testament. And so in this blowing of the trumpets, you don't understand that as a trumpet player would be today, but these are ram's horns being blown. So these ram's horns typically were used to call people to war. They were used to call people to worship, to call people to celebration, and to call people that there is a warning, an impending warning. There's danger underway. And that's very appropriate here because we're getting ready for the trumpet judgments. So this is a trumpet of warning for what is coming on the earth. But I think more significantly is it's a call to war. God is going to war against the rebellious, unbelieving world, against those that have rejected him, the world system, and he is going to bring down the walls of darkness in this world. Now, we see this in the book of Joshua. There was a trumpet that was blown. Do you remember when they circled around Jericho? And they came around Jericho. And what's really interesting, as you look at the book of Revelation, there are so many shadows that are being cast from the book of Joshua. Do you remember in Joshua at the very beginning? You come and you meet this angel of the Lord. And we find out that it's a pre-incarnate visitation of Jesus Christ. And he appears to Joshua. And Joshua, it's an interesting interchange. He said, are you on the enemy side or are you on our side? And the angel of the Lord essentially says, I haven't come here to take sides. I've come here to take over. And that's exactly what he does. And in the book of Revelation, we see there is a exalted, resurrected Lord Jesus Christ that appears. And indeed, in the book of Revelation, he's come to take over. Because in Joshua, they go in to possess and conquer the land. Here, Jesus Christ is coming back to possess and conquer the land. Also in the book of Joshua, it's interesting. When they come to Jericho, they march around it seven times in silence. And then they blow the seven horns and the walls of Jericho come down. In the book of Revelation, there's silence in heaven for about a half an hour. They blow the trumpets and the walls of the future city Babylon fall down. And so do the walls of the one world government of the Antichrist. So there's a lot of similarities that are quite interesting. Some other similarities come from the book of Exodus. Because you remember when God delivered Israel out of Egypt through Moses, there were 10 mighty plagues that came. These 10 plagues are in many ways replicated here in the book of Revelation that we're going to start reading about today during the trumpet judgments. Now, it's interesting, when Moses went into Egypt, each of those judgments was a judgment against one of the demonic gods that they served. For instance, the very first one, the Nile is turned to blood. Well, they worshiped the river Nile. They called her Mother Nile. And so God judges the river Nile. And you can see that again and again with each one of these judgments. I think about the frogs. You realize in Egypt they worship frogs. So God said, okay, I'll give you frogs. And there were frogs everywhere. And every time they said ribbit, ribbit, they were actually saying the Lord God Almighty reigns. Because it was a judgment upon Egypt. Let's look at verse 3. Then another angel. Now, some people, some commentators say this is Jesus because he was the angel of the Lord. I don't at all think this is Jesus because the word another is the Greek word allos, which means another of the same kind. Well, Jesus isn't an angel like these other seven kind. He is the Son of God. He is God. And so he's not like these other angels. So this is another just angel that has come. Another angel having a golden censer. A censer is where they kept the incense. The high priest would have the incense in the censer that the priest would minister with and came and stood at the altar. Since it's the incense, he's standing at the golden altar. Now again, you got to go back to the Old Testament. Do you remember in the tabernacle of Moses? This was also in the temple of Solomon and in the temple of Herod. There was, as you came to it, an altar. This was a brazen altar. That's where they would offer the animal sacrifices. Then you would go into what is known as the holy place. And in the holy place, there was the table of showbread, there was the golden candlestick, and then there was the golden altar, the altar of incense. And that altar of incense, the priest would go out to the brazen altar because the fire at the brazen altar was started by God. God sent fire to it, it started it, and that fire could never go out. They were very careful to never let it go out. Well, they would take fire from the brazen altar, they would take it to the golden altar, and that's how they would light it, because it was God's fire. And then they would take incense, a special incense that nobody could replicate. It was illegal to replicate it. And they would pour it on the top, and this beautiful smell and this beautiful aroma and fragrance would drift into the Holy of Holies, where the Ark of the Covenant was, which was considered the throne of God, where God was, and into his presence. And this is saying that that incense is the prayers of the saints. Our prayers waft into the presence of God. Isn't that just a beautiful picture? Let's read on in verse 3. He was given much incense that he should offer it, listen, with, that word with I think is interesting, with the prayers of the saints upon the golden altar, which was before the throne. Now, as I said, the fire at the golden altar had to come from the brazen altar, because at the brazen altar, sacrifice was made so their sins could become covered over and they could approach the presence of God. Now, I want you to understand this. The only prayers that are a fragrant aroma to God are those who begun at the altar of sacrifice. Our prayers always have to go through the finished work of Jesus. Because of what Jesus did on the cross, our sins have been covered over, the price has been paid, so our prayers can be heard in heaven. And they're the only ones that are acceptable. So you can pray in any other name and every other name, and it doesn't mean a thing. But prayers offered in the name of Jesus are always heard in heaven. You say, but some of my prayers aren't so great. I can relate to that. I'd have to say that some of my prayers, we're talking about incense, some of my prayers are kind of stinky. Because I look back on prayers I prayed years ago, and some of those prayers I think, oh, I'm so glad God didn't answer that. Does anybody feel like that? Some of my prayers are a little selfish and a little self-focused, and I'm just being honest, but that doesn't really matter because they're mixed with incense. I think of Romans chapter 8, because sometimes we don't know how to pray as we ought, it says in verse 26. But the Spirit himself makes intercession for us. So the Holy Spirit will pray through us, and it says with groanings that we can't even utter. Sometimes you go to God and it's just so desperate, it's so hard, all you can do is groan. But God takes those prayers and he uses them. And remember, Jesus is our heavenly high priest. And he's making intercession for us always. Our prayers are being mixed by God. And they're coming out as a sweet aroma to God. It's amazing. Your prayers matter. And all of your prayers are significant. And that is so encouraging to me. Because I'm a person who prays a lot. And some of my prayers maybe aren't the best, but God takes care of that. And they're a sweet aroma to God. Look at verse 4. And the smoke of the incense with the prayers of the saints ascended before God from the angel's hand. Here's my first observation from this passage. Our prayers are like unforgettable incense. I love that. When you pray a prayer, God never forgets it. They're like unforgettable incense. In fact, we read here in Psalm 141, verse 2, let my prayers be set before you as incense, the lifting up of my hands as the evening sacrifice. Now, it's very interesting in the book of Revelation, when prayers are prayed and worship is given, it usually results on judgment coming upon the earth. Isn't that fascinating? But throughout the scripture, how often are they worshiping God and praising and God fights the battles for them? Our part isn't to fight the battles physically or literally. It's to battle in the spirit through prayer and through worship. That's how we fight battles in the kingdom of God. And you turn to the book of Psalms, which we're doing right now in Radiant Word. If you're tracking with us in Radiant Word, we're in the imprecatory Psalms. And they're quite the Psalms. You read the imprecatory Psalms and just kind of gone, whoa. I mean, they say things like, kick out the teeth of the wicked. And I actually like those prayers. They do something for me. Because I see the injustice and the wickedness and the evil that's going on. It's like, yeah, that's what I'm talking about. Kick out the teeth of the wicked. But I want you to understand, those are not self-centered prayers. Those are not prayers simply for the advantage of the person against their enemies. It's calls for God's justice. Because what these people have done to God's people, Israel, is horrible. And so what they're doing is they're saying, God, be just. God, bring your vengeance. Bring your justice. And that is actually a holy, righteous prayer, so much so it's put in the book of Psalms. Now remember, there's seven trumpets that are going to go off. And these seven trumpets are going off because of the prayers of the saints. And you know why? Because God operates through our prayers. Now, he's a sovereign God, but he's made a sovereign choice to use our prayers to accomplish his will. Throughout the Bible, we see that we are God's vice regents. That's why we pray, for instance, in the Our Father or the Lord's Prayer, your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. We're praying for God's will and purpose to be done. Because we're not Islamic. We don't say, oh, the will of Allah be done. Whatever happens, happens. No, we believe in a God who we can affect what happens through our prayers to accomplish his will in the earth. Because there's a lot of things on earth that are not God's will. Let me tell you, the 60 million abortions that have happened in America are not God's will. They are not God's will. That is not God's purpose. And so we pray, oh God, intervene. We pray that. That is our prayer. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. And it's very interesting in Revelation chapter 5, again, we see prayers being lifted up as incense. And in Revelation 6, we read this beginning in verse 9, which is the prayers of the martyrs under the altar. So they're under this golden altar. And here's what they're praying. When we open this fifth seal, I saw under the altar the souls of those who had been slain for the word of God. These are the martyrs of the tribulation. And for the testimony which they held. And they cried with a loud voice. Now listen what they're saying. How long, O Lord? Now, have you prayed that one before? Boy, I prayed that. God, I've been praying. How long until you do this? How long, O Lord? How long? Holy and true, until you judge and avenge our blood on those who dwell on the earth. So I believe what we're seeing happen here in Revelation chapter 8 with the trumpet judgments is an answer to these people's prayers. God is answering their prayers. God will answer your prayers. And I believe this is a cumulative prayer over the generations and over the centuries. There's a prayer synergy that's happened because of all the people over all the ages who prayed, God bring justice, God judge, God do what's right. This is an answer to their prayers. Now, I want to read another passage. This almost seems like an aside, but it is so helpful in understanding what's happening here in the book of Revelation. And you can find this passage in Luke chapter 1. Very familiar, because this is part of the story of Jesus' first coming. We're looking at his second coming. This is part of his first coming. And so we read in verse 5, there was in the days of Herod, the king of Judea, a certain priest named Zechariah. Now, Zechariah was a priest. He was part of the tribe of Levi, was the idea, and that he would serve the priestly office. He would go into the temple of Herod, and he would minister, and this was a very special privilege, to minister at this golden altar. So it says, of the division of Abijah, his wife was of the daughters of Aaron, and her name was Elizabeth. Verse 6, and they were both righteous before God, walking in all the commandments and ordinances of the Lord blameless. But they had no child, because Elizabeth was barren. And now listen, they were both well advanced in years. Now, when you see Zechariah's response to the angel, you recognize being so advanced in years, they'd basically given up. You ever been there? Where you were praying for something, expecting something, hoping for something, but then it looks impossible. Totally impossible. I'm just going to give up. Never mind. Never mind, God, I've been praying, but never mind. It's been so long. How can it even be? That's what's going on with this guy named Zechariah. Look at verse 8. So it was that while he was serving as priest before God in the order of his division, according to the custom of the priesthood, his lot fell to, look at this, burn incense. That's what we're talking about in the book of Revelation. when he went into the temple of the Lord. Verse 10, and the whole multitude of the people were standing outside at the hour of incense. And what were they doing? They were praying, it says. They were praying outside at the hour of incense. So I want you to hear Jewish tradition. Jewish tradition was that while the incense was being offered, they were to be praying. And you know how long they say they prayed? About a half an hour. Because the ceremony took about a half an hour. Let's go back to the book of Revelation. What are they doing? What's going on in this silence in heaven for a half an hour? The prayers of the saints are wafting in. The prayers of the saints are wafting up. And God is about to answer the prayers of the saints. But let's go ahead and let's read here in verse 11. Then an angel of the Lord appeared to him, appeared to Zechariah, standing on the right side of the altar of incense. So he's ministering at the altar of incense on the left side, and suddenly he sees an angel over on the right side. And we read, and when Zechariah saw him, he was troubled, and fear fell upon him. Now, let me just give you an interesting observation. This is so funny to me. When God sends an angel, and he appears to a man, the men typically are so afraid, they're dumbfounded. They're so afraid, they can't even speak. But when an angel appears to a woman, they just keep on talking. I mean, have you seen that? Mary, Elizabeth, they just keep going. Just a thought. Verse 13. But the angel said to him, do not be afraid, Zechariah, for your prayer, listen to this, your prayer is heard, and your wife Elizabeth will bear you a son, and you shall call his name John. I love that. I love that. Notice, he has quit praying. He has quit believing. He gave up a long time ago, but the angel's still hearing the prayers. What are those prayers? Those prayers he prayed a decade ago. Those prayers he prayed 20 years ago. God is still hearing those prayers because they're an unforgettable fragrance before God. Folks, your prayers you prayed 3 decades ago are still being heard by God. They're still making a difference in the realm of the spirit. It reminds me of my wife and her perfume. She has a kind of a unique perfume, and she's been wearing it for decades. And it's just so convenient for me. Because every Christmas, every birthday, every Valentine, I know what to get her. It's just, it's a slam dunk. You know, I already got it in Amazon. I just hit the button and boom, there it is again. It's wonderful. It's wonderful. But it's a very strong fragrance, and it's a very distinct fragrance. So much so that when my wife Kelly will go into the church office, women throughout the building will start texting her and say, I can tell you're here because I can smell you. Now, for teenage boys, that may not be a good thing. But with Kelly, it's a good thing because it's a good fragrance. There's all kinds of stories about that. I remember sometimes she'll get a text from the North Campus here, and we'll be at home or at the Central Campus, and they'll say, Kelly, you were here at the North Campus, weren't you? Because I can smell that you were here because of that fragrance. The ultimate, though, one time somebody called her and said, hey, were you just at Walmart on Woodman? And she said, yes, I smelled you there. Now, that's extraordinary. It's this unforgettable fragrance. Folks, let me tell you, that's your prayers. They're an unforgettable fragrance before God. So I want you to understand, our prayers are not forgotten. Prayers that are prayed are still in play. So don't fall into unbelief. Don't give up. Don't think those prayers were worthless just because it didn't work out the way I thought or when I thought it would. Let me read you a scripture very quickly here. I want to move along, but I can't get over Hebrews chapter 10. I've always been intrigued by this scripture. Beginning in verse 35, the writer of Hebrews says, therefore, do not cast away your confidence, which has great reward. God is a rewarder of those who diligently seek him. For you have need of endurance, so that after you've done the will of God, you may receive the promise. For yet a little while, and he who is coming will come and will not tarry. Now the just shall live by faith. But if anyone draws back, my soul has no pleasure in him. But we are not of those who draw back to perdition, but of those who believe to the saving of the soul. Then it says in Hebrews 11:1, now faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things, listen, not seen. See, a lot of us think you have great faith if you keep seeing everything you pray for constantly. Hebrews says the opposite. In fact, it talks about great heroes of faith that were always looking forward to Jesus and never saw his coming. But they were great heroes of faith because they kept believing. Folks, don't stop believing. Don't stop trusting. Don't start doubting because your prayer wasn't answered when you thought it would, the way you thought it would, because your prayers are an unforgettable incense before God. Your prayers matter. They're important. And I love what Jesus said when he said, when the Son of Man comes, will he find faith on the earth? And I say, if he comes and Radiant Church is here, he will find faith on the earth, because we're not going to quit believing. We're going to keep standing. We're not going to stop praying. Look at verse 5. Then the angel took the censer, and this is fascinating. He filled it with fire from the altar. So the censer's where the incense was. He filled it with fire from the altar, and then listen what he does. He threw it to the earth, and there was noises and thunder and lightning and an earthquake. That reminds you of Mount Sinai. But I want you to see this picture. The prayers go up, the angel grabs it, and the judgment comes down. Now, I want you to think of it this way. You've been praying for that unsaved loved one for a long time. You've been praying for that prodigal son or daughter a long time. Your prayers are going up someday. God's going to take it, and it's going to be thrown right back down to the earth, and it's going to come to pass. Folks, that's how it works. So don't stop praying. Don't stop believing. So in other words, the prayers come up and the judgment comes down. Look at verse 6. So the seven angels who had the seven trumpets prepared themselves to sound. And they are going to sound trumpets of judgment. With each trumpet, a new judgment is going to be released. So here's my second observation. God is slow to anger, but he will judge justly. Now, I love the fact that God is slow to anger when it comes to me. But sometimes I'm not so happy about him being slow to anger when it comes to other people. People that have wronged me or hurt me or doing horrible things in this world today. You know, I look at some of the awful things that are going on. I said, God, why not judge? Come on. Somebody who had a real problem with this was Jonah. You know Jonah's story. He's told to go to Nineveh and to pronounce that judgment is coming. But he doesn't want to because he hates Nineveh. They're his enemy. They did despicable things. They would actually skin people alive. I mean, it's just hell. They deserve judgment. If anybody deserved judgment, Nineveh deserved judgment. And they're about ready to come and invade Israel in some centuries and absolutely destroy the nation of Israel. And so Jonah's a prophet. He knows bad things are coming from this place, so he doesn't want anything to do with them. So he flees to Tarshish. Well, we all know the story. God interrupts him with some kind of sea creature, and that sea creature takes him, spits him up back at Nineveh. And so he goes into Nineveh, and he has one message, just real simple. Judgment's coming. Judgment's coming. That's it. Judgment's coming. And the whole city repents. I mean, greatest revival in the history of the world. The whole city comes to God. It's just incredible. Jonah's the most successful preacher of the gospel in history. And so how does Jonah respond to this? Well, he prays a prayer. You want to hear his prayer? You think stinky prayers happen? Listen to this one. Jonah in 4:2 says this. So he prayed to the Lord and he said, "Ah, Lord, was not this what I said when I was still in my country? Therefore I fled previously to Tarshish, for I know that you are a gracious and merciful God. Slow to anger, abundant in loving kindness, one who relents from doing harm." Now, I know if you have the Bible on cassette, and we don't do cassettes, do we? The Bible on, boy, I am old. I'm so sorry. I always show how old I am, but I used to listen to Bible on cassette all the time. Now I have my phone, and I listen to it from there. But when we hear it there, here's how it usually reads. Oh God, you are gracious and merciful God, slow to anger, abundant in loving kindness. But that's not how Jonah prayed this. He's like, God, you are gracious. How dare you? And you are merciful. Oh, that just burns me up. You are slow to anger. How dare you? That's how Jonah's praying. He's furious at God because God's so merciful and God's so gracious. And that is how God is. He's slow to judge. He's slow to get angry. In fact, the Old Testament says that that's his strange fire. That's his strange fire. It's not what God usually does. But he's just. And like the judge trying the case of the serial murderer, he must judge justly. And that is what God is going to do here in the book of Revelation. So we're getting ready for the seven trumpet judgments. And when the seven trumpet judgments sound, the first four of those judgments we're going to look at today, they are judgments upon the earth, actually upon nature. And then there's three judgments, and those three judgments are actually toward individuals. So let's start with the four judgments, and let's begin here in verse 7. The first angel sounded. So the first angel blows his trumpet, and hail and fire follow, mingled with blood. And they were thrown to the earth. Remember, they throw it to the earth. And a third of the trees were burned up, and all the green grass was burned up. So this is the first trumpet. And it includes a third of the earth being burned up, a third of the trees being burned up, and a third of the green grass being burned up. Let me start by saying this. Some people see in all these judgments nuclear holocaust. They see nuclear weapons being used. It could be, because a lot of it sounds like that. But I believe it is probably actually just God intervening, because it's a third, a third, a third. God is showing very precisely, I'm in control here. I'm judging the earth. And I know there's a lot of concern about ecology today, but let me say there's coming a day when this planet is going to be devastated by God. We should be good stewards of this planet, but no, this planet is only temporary. Things are running out, and God is going to deal with it. So all of the grass is burned up. You can't have any livestock. This is referring to fruit trees and plants and vegetation being burned up. Our food supply is going to be in big, big trouble. Look at verses 8 to 9. Then the second angel sounded, and something like a great mountain burning with fire was thrown into the earth. Now, something like is a simile that John uses all the time because he can't describe it. Have you ever seen something you just can't describe? It's so incredible. That's John. He has no words to describe this. So he says it's like a big mountain, and maybe that could be a picture of Sinai in a sense. But my feeling is, as you read it, this is probably a meteorite coming to our planet, but he doesn't know how to describe it. And he says, something like a great mountain burning with fire was thrown into the sea, and a third of the sea became blood, and a third of the living creatures in the sea died, and a third of the ships were destroyed. Now notice, it turns to blood. That was much like in Egypt, where the Nile was turned to blood. But I want you to see what happens in the second trumpet. A third of the sea becomes blood. A third of the sea life is killed. Now, that's really significant. For one thing, not only are fish dead that we eat, but the plankton in the sea provides something like 50 to 80% of the oxygen on this planet. And it would reduce our oxygen for human beings about 20%. You think it's hard to breathe in Colorado Springs now? Wait until then. And then a third of the sea vessels are destroyed. There's about 50,000 vessels at sea right now, and a third of them are gone. So sea commerce is wiped out. Verse 10, then the third angel sounded, and a great star fell from heaven, burning like a torch, sounds like a comet, and it fell on a third of the rivers and the springs of water. This is the fourth trumpet. And when it happens, the spring water's polluted. A third of it. So drinking water is polluted. Can you imagine if the Colorado River was completely polluted and undrinkable? Something like 40 million Americans depend on their drinking water from the Colorado River, and it's gone. Verse 11, the name of the star that fell is Wormwood. A third of the waters became wormwood, which means bitter. And many men died from the water because it was made bitter. Now, of course, if you know your Old Testament, again, you're thinking about Israel wandering in the wilderness. And remember, they came to some water called Marah, and the water was bitter, and they couldn't drink it. So God told them to take a tree, cut it down, throw it in the water, and the water became sweet, and they were able to drink it. It's much like Jesus coming into our bitter lives, and his cross comes in, and it changes our bitter lives to sweet lives because of what he did. This is the opposite. This is sweet water, but it's turned bitter by what happened with this destruction of wormwood. And here's my third observation. And this is really important. It almost sounds like an aside, but I think it gets right to the point of what we're talking about today. And that is that we must forgive committing all judgment to God. Now, why do I say that? Because the water was turned bitter. A lot of people's lives become bitter. They become bitter through unforgiveness. And I want you to think about unforgiveness. Why do we become unforgiving? Why do we become resentful toward people and what they've done to us? Because there's a sense of justice in us. We know people ought to pay for what they did. And that's good and that's right, because justice needs to be done. There's a justice in it that says somebody needs to pay. One way I know this, if you've ever had anybody wrong you in some little slight or some little way, and then something just devastating happens to them. You know, they go into bankruptcy, they have a horrible disease, something just awful happens to them, and you're like, okay, I'm good. I'm not gonna hold it against them anymore. Why? You feel like they paid. Come on, you guys, you're real stoic, but you know stuff like that happens because we believe somebody ought to pay for it. And so when somebody does this wrong, it's like somebody needs to pay. And of course, what we need to understand is on the cross, Jesus Christ paid for their sin, paid for our sin. So our job is not to bring justice. Our job is to trust God with the justice. Our job is to forgive, to release them and to let them go. And if not, we'll become bitter. And bitterness is a horrible thing. Let me read from Hebrews, because this is a great passage on it. Hebrews 12:15, the writer of Hebrews says, looking carefully lest anyone fall short of the grace of God, lest any root, listen to that, root of bitterness springing up causes trouble, and by this many become defiled. Bitterness is subterranean. You may have a bitter heart and not even know it, but then that person's name comes up and all of a sudden it springs up. All of a sudden a situation happens that reminds you of what occurred in the past and it springs up. We've all had that. You guys are so good at looking pious, but you know what I'm talking about. It springs up and it can destroy your life if you don't deal with it. You've got to deal with it. You got to let Jesus deal with it. When we lived in San Diego, we purchased a home that had these beautiful bird of paradise trees. It's one of the reasons we bought the home. Just, they were gorgeous. So I was commenting to a friend about them and he said, oh, those are a problem. He said, because they're planted so close to your house. So I went to the guy who owned the company that did our lawns and I asked him about it. And his name was Jesus, actually Jesus. But I asked him about him. And Jesus said, oh, there's a problem there. He said, they are so close to your house that they could be pushing into your foundation and can destroy your foundation. So very reluctantly, I asked him to uproot them. And Jesus came in and uprooted the plants from my life. And that's what Jesus needs to do in our lives. Because there can be a root of bitterness and it can destroy the foundation of your life. And you need to ask Jesus to come in and uproot the bitterness. But to do that, you've got to forgive. You've got to release. And you've got to put judgment into the hands of God. Because somebody has to pay. We know that. But see, we are looking at what Jesus did and we're saying, I've been forgiven of so much, I can forgive. And now I can put the judgment into the hands of God. Do you realize Jesus had to do that? I mean, the sinless, spotless, perfect Son of God, we read in 1 Peter chapter 2 that when he was suffering horribly, and unjustly, nobody has suffered unjustly like Jesus suffered. I mean, he never committed any sin, yet he's suffering like every sinner. And it says that instead of judging those people doing it, which he could have, remember, he could have called for legions of angels. Instead, it says he trusted himself to the just judge who judges righteously. So with Caiaphas and Pilate and Herod and the Roman soldiers and the Jews that rejected him, instead of trying to get judgment on him, he put him in the hands of the just judge who judges justly. And he said, God, I'm not in a position to judge this. I put it in your hands. And let me tell you, we're not in a position to judge. You know, in the Old Testament, it was eye for eye, tooth for tooth. The problem is if we really kept that today, we'd all be eyeless and toothless. And it's not like, okay, you knocked out my side tooth, I'm going to knock your side tooth out. No, I'm going to take out the whole row because we always want to get back more than what actually happened. And so because of that, in the New Testament, the idea is justice needs to be served, but Jesus took our judgment. Now I put the judgment in his hands. And that is exactly what we have to do. And here in the book of Revelation, the prayers of the martyrs aren't saying, I'm going to go get him. It's God, you go get him. God, it's in your hands. Look at verse 12. We're almost done. Then the fourth angel sounded, and a third of the sun was struck, a third of the moon, a third of the stars, and a third of them were darkened. A third of the day did not shine, and likewise the night. Reminds you of Exodus 10, and again, the 10 plagues in Egypt, where there was darkness all over the land. And Jesus talks about this. In Luke chapter 21, verse 25, speaking of the time of tribulation, he said, and there'll be signs in the sun and in the moon and in the stars and on earth, distresses of nation with perplexity and seas and waves roaring. You know, it's interesting. One of the gods Egypt served was Ra. That was their chief god, and he was the god of the sun. And so the god of Israel judges the god of the sun and shows he's the true god. No, again, I get back to ecology, and I believe in ecology. I mean, I do everything I can to be a good steward of what God has given us. But it's so interesting. Some people are obsessed with it. Have you seen those people? I've seen videos of people doing these wild chants to plants. You know, it's just strange stuff. What they have done, instead of, as Romans 1 said, instead of worshiping the creator, they're worshiping the creation. And God's going to judge the creation. This is a bad time to be, you know, an ecologist in that sense. Verse 13. I mean, can you imagine? You'd be having a conniption fit. You want to save the whales, and God just killed a third of them. But verse 13. And I looked, and I heard an angel flying through the midst of heaven. Now, your Bible may say an eagle, because it could be translated eagle. But remember, in Revelation 4:7, the creatures were like eagles. And so I think that may be what it's referring to, because it could be translated either way. Flying through the midst of heaven and saying with a loud voice, whoa, 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 which means it's going to get a lot worse. You think this was bad? It's going to get worse. Whoa, whoa, whoa to the inhabitants of the earth because of the remaining blast of the trumpet of the three angels who are about to sound. Okay, we finished the text. We're going to come back next week and we're going to look at the next three plagues. If you thought those plagues were good, wait till you see what's coming. It's like it's really science fiction crazy in these next three. But I want to close with just the thought about bitterness and unforgiveness, because that's so important. We cannot be bitter. We have got to commit it into the hands of God, because God knows best. I have read some amazing stories, though, of when somebody is badly wrong. I think of one story from Cuba that I could tell, which is really good. But let me tell you another story of an individual who was so wronged, and he put the judgment into the hands of God. Does anybody here, you're kind of a younger group, but do you anybody remember Rex Humbard? Okay, I'm the oldest person in the room. But Rex Humbard was this television evangelist back when we had like three channels, and he was on every Sunday. And he had a father who was a very godly man. And this very godly man was one of the early Pentecostal preachers. And he was harassed, he was attacked, he preached against sin, and the sinners came after him. That's essentially what happened. These four men took him, and they had him beaten with a whip. And it was so bad that he walked away, and as he's walking away, he could hear the blood sloshing in his boots. That's bad. But he committed the judgment of these men into God's hands. He said, God, I'm not going to judge him. My job is to forgive him and love him. You deal with him. And God dealt with him. All four of those men in the next 2 years died horrible, horrific deaths. Now, I know some people hear that and they say, that's what I'm talking about. That's what I'm looking for. But I got to have you understand this. He put it in God's hands. And God knew it was best. And in this case, that's what was best. That's what needed to happen. But sometimes, here's what's frustrating. Somebody really hurt you, you put them in God's hands, God blesses them. Because it's the goodness and mercy of God that leads people to repentance, and sometimes that's what he does. That's where you have to trust him. You have to trust him with it. I think of Stephen being stoned to death, and instead of trying to get judgment, he said, lay not this sin to their charge. One of the men who was involved in that was a man named Saul of Tarsus, who was met on the Damascus Road by Jesus and became Paul, the greatest apostle in history. Folks, I gotta tell you, God knows best. God knows best. Don't hold on to that bitterness. Don't hold on to that unforgiveness, because it's going to burn in your soul. It's going to be a bitterness that destroys the foundation of your life. You got to let it go and put it in the hands of God. Forgive and love and let God handle it. Let's pray together. Father, I thank you for your faithfulness and your goodness. And I pray today that every one of us that have been wronged or hurt, or those who are dealing with issues over even some of the things going on in our world that are so atrocious, that God, instead of bringing judgment and speaking ill and speaking evilly of people, instead, God, we put it into your hands as the just judge who will judge rightly. And you're going to throw down whatever needs to be thrown down to the earth to fulfill your will, your purpose, your plan, to work in these people's lives so that we can simply love and worship and trust that you're a God who is faithful. Amen.